Minnes edasi, meie järgmine ettekandja tuleb Norrast. Tema nimeks on Jörg Aarneus. Tema räägib meile siis süsiniku kinnipüüdmise kasutamise tööstuslikust rakendusest ja see rakenduse laiendamisest. Jörg on nafta- ja gaasitööstuse madal süsiniku sisaldusega teenuste portfelli globaalse just positsioonile. Okei, siin on tõlke viga. Ilmselt portfelli haldajaga on tegemist ja tegemist on globaalse portfelliga, tehnoloogia portfelliga siis. Tal on olnud juhtiv roll rahvusvaheliste standardite väljatöötamisel, ära märgitud ISO 27914, ehk siis süsinikdioksiidi geoloogiline säilitamine. Viimastel aastatel on ta tegelenud mitmete tegevustega, mis on seotud jõupingutustega energeetika ülemineku lahendamiseks. Siis see tähendab, et me peaksime siis fossiilset kütustest üle minema, kas kasutusest CO2 neilamist ja kasutamist või siis ilmselt süsinikurikka materjali kasutamise muutmist, vähendamist. Nii, hõlmab vesiniku kui energiakandja kasutamist ja selle vastava seadusliku ja tehnoloogilise raamistiku väljatöötamist. Nii, Jörg on doktorikraadiga rakendusmatemaatikas ja on keskendunud reservoaride modelleerimise simulatsioonile. So Jörg, this was your introduction in Estonian and as I can just say that thanks for thanks for connecting and the floor is yours. You have 20 minutes, please.
Thank you, Marcus. No, I couldn't understand all of the Estonian, so I'll start from here. Thank you to the organizers for inviting us to give a presentation. I will give a perspective on the current status of the CCS industry and how we see that moving forward and what are some of the key challenges to the scaling of the CCS industry. So just to start, carbon capture and storage involves, of course, the capture of CO2 from industrial sources, typically power plants, or it could be cement plants, steel mills, ammonia plants, types of natural gas processing, a lot of different sources. And then purification of that CO2, which you then transport either by pipelines or ships to a site where you will be injecting that some thousand or more meters below the surface into a storage site where it will be retained permanently on a basis. So this has been an active area of work for DNVGL for some 20 years. And over the past 10 years, we've been doing more than 100 projects related to assisting the industry in addressing challenges such as how do you benchmark and validate the performance of CO2 capture technology? What kind of environmental risks do you have associated with capture, for instance, related to emissions of amines? What kind of effects do you have on this transport of CO2 in pipelines? Can you use the same type of standards that you use for natural gas, or do you need to make modifications? And what kind of concepts design would be best suited to transport CO2 in bulk? And then also on the storage aspects, a particular issue has been related to demonstrating the security of storage so that nothing will leak, and also the permanence of storage. But I'll start a little bit from scratch, and then I'll go through some of the main aspects. But one thing I'd like to mention is that the CCS industry is nothing new, really. We've been doing now CO2 storage, so CCS in the that sense, for some 25 years. But the actual sort of knowledge and experience related to CCS starts with the CO2 EOR experience in the US, so the use of CO2 injection for enhancing oil recovery, which goes back to about 1970. So we have some 50 years of experience on that aspect. And also with CO2 capture. An important change now is that we are looking at much larger scales and much more widespread deployment. But on the basis of that type of experience, it's been recognized that the CCS industry is mature enough to develop standards. And now you can see that we have standards, ISO standards developed for each part of the CCS value chain. And DNVGL has been very sort of central in the development of this. And these standards sort of build on top of previously developed standards by DNVGL. So, just to take a couple of topics, when it comes to CCS, a frequently raised question is, what is sort of the actual emission benefit of applying CCS? And to answer that question, you need to keep in mind that you often sort of measure the CO2 emissions per unit of project that you're producing. That could be power, or it could be, let's say, hydrogen, or it could be things like a ton of steel or a ton of cement. And to understand sort of how you are reducing that footprint, you take a look at the picture to the left here, where you can, might see like what kind of CO2 emissions you have when you're producing, let's say, 1 kilowatt hour of power. If you're adding on to CCS, then you need to have additional energy to perform the CO2 capture in particular. And that means that you're actually using more power to produce, let's say, the same output. And then based on that total emissions, which is shown on the bottom here, you might be capturing, let's say, 90%. So then you're reducing the CO2 emissions down to the bot or the left sort of dotted line here, and the CO2 avoided is measured then relative to the baseline emissions. So that is how you estimate the baseline CO2 avoided emissions. When it comes to CO2 transport, I did mention initially that there's two main modes of transport. The most widely applied today is the pipeline transport. This has particularly been applied in the CO2 EUR industry in the US. For the CO2 storage projects that you have in the world, there's not that many. Actually, you only have 5 today. Some of these are basically injecting at site, like the Sleipner field in offshore Norway, as well as for the Gorgon project offshore Australia. But then you have also Snøhvit, where you have a 160-kilometer pipeline, and you also have the project in Algeria. And you have, for instance, the Quest project in Alberta, Canada, where you have an 80-kilometer pipeline. The advantage of a pipeline is that you can take large CO2 volumes quite effectively, but there's a significant capex investment into the CCS. And if you're sort of terminating the project early, then there's sort of limited residual value in having that type of pipeline. Some of you may have heard of the Northern Lights project or the Longship project, which is now being implemented as well in Norway. And this is the first CCS project that is looking into transporting CO2 by ship, or at least the first project that will become operational. And in this case, the thinking is to transport the CO2 by ship from the capture sites close to Oslo to the west coast, where it will be offloaded onto a temporary storage and then transported by pipeline to the offshore storage sites. There is limited experience with regards to CO2 shipping in the world. There's some 3 small ships in operation today related to transport of food grade CO2. But these ships that will be used for the Northern Lights project are much bigger. So they're like 5 times the size. But in the future, if we want to use CO2 ships, we'll be looking at actually even larger ships. When it comes to CO2 storage, a major concept here is that you're sort of storing the CO2 in the same way that oil and gas has been trapped in the subsurface for millions of years. So basically, you're relying on the physical trap, which is provided by a cap rock or a sealing layer that does not permit the CO2 to flow upwards. It should be noted that CO2, when you inject that into a storage site, it's buoyant and would rise to the surface if it hasn't been stopped by a physical barrier. A key point here is that you need to identify potential leakage pathways and demonstrate that they don't have the capability or the likelihood that they will be able to transmit CO2. So this needs to be demonstrated. If you're injecting in CO2 into an existing oil field, a lot of that sort of evidence has been provided by nature, but you need to have specific focus on the wells. If you're injecting into a saline aquifer, then nature hasn't provided that evidence, and then means that you need to provide additional evidence looking at sort of the features that will provide the trapping. Another concept is that you also often talk about a storage complex. So it does not only include the reservoir, but it includes several layers also above the reservoir. And you don't talk about leakage unless it actually migrates outside of the storage complex. I would also like to add one more thing. So when you talk about CO2 storage, you're like talking about actually four different type of mechanisms that contribute to ensure long-term storage security. And these act on different timescales. I did mention that what's called the structural or stratigraphic trapping. This is the sort of physical trap that is has been trapping oil and gas. But in addition to that, when you are migrating CO2 in a storage site, then some of the CO2 will sort of be trapped by the pore pressure by actually sort of being absorbed onto the pore walls. And this is called residual trapping. Over time, some of the CO2 will also be dissolved in the aquifer brine or in the host fluids. And when the CO2 is dissolved into water, it actually becomes heavier than water and will start to sink. So that will also provide a trapping mechanism. And over very long periods of time, some of the CO2 will also have chemical reactions with the host rock and then basically be trapped in a mineral trapping form. So you can see from this slide that there's different time scales at play here, but how that actually plays out at each individual site needs to be modeled because it depends on a lot of different factors, such as the amount of water that is being coming in contact with the CO2 and what are the migration pathways and what are the rocks in the reservoir. But I hope this provides a little bit of understanding of the concept of CCS. So now we'll talk a little bit about how we see CCS scale. And CCS is first and foremost the only real technology or technology that can reduce CO2 emissions from the use of fossil fuels at large scale. It can also be applied, for instance, to cement, where two-thirds of the emissions comes from the calcination process, so not from the use of fossil fuels, but in overall, it relates to the use of fossil fuels in the world. This picture provides an outlook on the amount of fossil fuels that will be used towards 2050. Today, more than 80% of the energy demand comes from fossil fuels, but we see that declining towards 54% in 2050. But in order to be compliant with the Paris Agreement targets, we're actually looking at trajectories that will allow us to become net zero in 2050. And that also means that a majority of the emissions that comes from the use of fossil fuels will need to be captured and stored. So this should suggest that there's a significant need for carbon capture and storage towards 2050. And this might also be reflected in this graph, which actually shows that CCS deployment will increase quite significantly towards 2050, but it starts to scale in 2040. So it starts to scale, or at least scale for real, in 2040, according to this model. In 2050, we have some bit more than 2 gigatons of CO2 that will be captured, according to this model. And that compares to our outlook for 2050 of about 18 gigatons of CO2 emitted globally. So we're nowhere near than the carbon neutral society. And 2 gigatons is also just, let's say, 10% of the total emissions. So it doesn't really solve the problem as a whole. And it's too slow to basically meet the targets under the Paris Agreement. The scenarios that are being published by others, such as the IEA, looking at the Paris Agreement compliance scenarios, might have a threefold uptake of CCS by 2050. But one of the key challenges here is that it starts to scale too late. And in particular, when you look at the 54% of energy that comes from fossil fuels, a very significant part of that, about 30% in total, is from natural gas. So natural gas is going to be the biggest energy source by 2050, and it's actually be followed by oil. Coal will be much smaller. But that means that in particular, we need to decarbonize gas. It's not that easy to decarbonize oil because it has a sort of a different consumption pattern, but a lot of natural gas is used at large industrial sources and can be decarbonized. But this graph actually solves the part of the problem that even in 2050, only some 13% of gas consumption is being decarbonized. And when I'm saying it's decarbonized, it's either through applying CCS to power plants, so for gas-fired power plants, or reforming the natural gas to hydrogen and using the hydrogen as an energy vector. I said that one of the problems is that CCS starts to scale too slowly. And I should have also mentioned that our model is not a model that is compliant with the Paris Agreement targets. It's actually a forecast and not a scenario. It's what we believe will unfold towards 2050. But we have also done supplementary studies looking at what happens if we are constraining the model to meet carbon neutrality. And these, what I'm showing here is projections for Europe regarding the uptake of CCS if we are to meet the carbon neutrality targets in 2050, which is required under the European Green Deal. And one of the immediate things that we see is that CCS starts to scale earlier, and also that the final uptake of CCS is much larger. We're getting about a gigaton of CO2 emissions being captured by CCS, whereas the final sort of endpoint in our model was about a half a gigaton, but the uptake in 2040 was much, much lower than that, so well below 200 million tons. Whereas here you can see that in 2040, you're over 800 million tons in 2040 by CCS. The applications would be either for power, for manufacturing purposes, or for using CO2, reforming gas to hydrogen. So when we look forward, what are actually the main challenges to allowing continued scaling of CCS? One of the frequently raised problems is the lack of a sufficient CO2 price. In essence, it has been free or cheap to emit CO2 for decades or for up until now. We are seeing now some carbon pricing mechanisms in play, but in general, the carbon price is not sufficient to make it provide a business case for CCS. What we're seeing on this graph is the cost or predicted cost related to the deployment of CCS to power plants, and particularly coal-fired power plants in this perspective. And the dotted line shows that there's sort of a trajectory related to learning curves that will drive the price down. Two of the projects that we have in operation today are the one from Boundary Dam and Petronova. So you're seeing that these are on the level of $100 per ton or more for the Boundary Dam, and Petronova would be around $70 per ton. But the Sask Power, the operator of Boundary Dam, has also planned a second project called Shand, and actually said that they would be able to achieve some 70% cost reduction. So of course that would take us down to levels that might provide a different picture on this. The EU ETS is maybe some 25 to 30 euros per ton today, but you're also having incentives such as the 45Q tax credits in the US, which provides $50 per ton for CCS. And that has actually, just over the past years, triggered more than 10 new projects occurring in the US large-scale projects. So it's really triggering a new industry to take off there. And it's at a level that will be sufficient to incentivize CCS for a lot of different applications, including for ammonia production, hydrogen production, and gas reforming, gas processing, and ethanol production. Another problem, I guess, is related to the lack of the existing infrastructure. And this is because most of the projects that we have seen up until today has been based on having one capture source and one storage site. This is now about to change. There's much more focus on having, let's say, one storage site that can take CO2 from multiple sources. This is the case for the Northern Lights project, and there are several cluster developments both in the Netherlands and the UK, as well as in other parts of the world. So the current thinking is that you shouldn't sort of take one source to one sink, but you should rather look at multiple different clusters of the sources, try to develop an infrastructure that would enable those to tie into one storage site or a multiple storage sites. So that is part of the development, and we see that going forward. The third part, I guess, is related to public perception. If some of you may remember back to some 10 years ago, where there was significant public opposition to a couple of projects in the European Union. One was for the Vattenfall project in Germany, and the other was for a project by Shell in the Netherlands. Both of these projects were actually stopped by public opposition. In one case, it was more related to the people feeling that they were not compensated for the development and the fearing that their house prices might drop. In the other circumstance in Germany, the plans was to develop a CO2 storage site in a quite sort of beautiful nature area. And the residents there were quite opposed to this. So they were able to mobilize a significant opposition. So in general, I think at least in Europe, you're looking at offshore storage. In other parts of the world, it's more acceptable with onshore storage, but it's unlikely that you'll see significant large-scale onshore storage in Europe, I think, over the next 10 years maybe. One of the things that DNVGL provides in this context is that we provide certification of CO2 storage site, and that is of course intended to provide stakeholders with trust in the ability of the CO2 storage site to store the CO2 securely over centuries. So with that, I think I'm just going to end with this slide. Norway was a pioneer when it comes to CO2 storage. We had the first CO2 storage project in the world. It's the Sleipner project from 1996. And we also have the Snøhvit project in the north of Norway, which was the third project looking at CO2 storage. So that has been triggered by the Norwegian carbon tax, which comes on top of the EU ETS price. But basically that has allowed Norway to build competence across the full value chain in this area. And three of the companies that are central in this development is DNVGL and SINTEF and Technology Center Mongstad. So we have actually decided to collaborate and signed a memorandum of understanding. And together we offer the European industry advice on how to realize affordable and feasible and safe CCUS solutions. But now I think we'll hear more from Technology Center Mongstad and SINTEF in the next talk. And I would like to thank you for your kind attention and thank you for being allowed to share my reflections.
Well, thanks, Jörg, for giving the presentation. Though we are almost done with the time, I still have a couple of questions for you. So first would be the question by Valdur Lotve. He is asking from you, if it would be make much more sense to use hydrogen, the caverns where you usually store CO2 for storage of hydrogen. How do you feel about that?
So you're talking about storage in caverns now. So caverns generally has a very limited capacity. It's being used for natural gas storage, and it's also being used for hydrogen storage in very few places in the world, but they don't really have a sufficient capacity to store CO2 at the volumes considered. So in order to store the CO2 for these projects, you need to consider either aquifer storage or depleted oil and gas fields. Yeah.
But can you store also hydrogen in the same, let's say, cavities where you store CO2 right now? You showed the slide where you just kind of pump the CO2 underground. You have a cap layer. Can you store there also hydrogen?
In principle, yes. The only project that you're storing CO2, no hydrogen in the subsurface today are in salt caverns. So this is, let's say, demonstrated. When it comes to storage of hydrogen into aquifers and depleted oil and gas fields, that's more at the research stage right now. There's additional concerns to take into account with regards to interactions between hydrogen and you're sort of not getting the same, necessarily the purity. So I would say that over the the next 5 to 10 years, it's unlikely that you'll see hydrogen storage in the same types of formations, but over the long term, that might be applicable.
Well, thank you, Jörg. That was all for today. Thanks again for presentation, and let's say we upload to you.